this gentleman right over here a great reason.
So, what was Miss Travers really like?
Oh.
She was a troubled little girl. You know what I'm talking about? When she was a little girl, she was a very troubled. She had a hero worship for her father, which is a nice thing when you have a father and you love him very much. But this fellow was a failure. He was faulted. He was not a very successful human being. He was unfortunately terribly hooked on booze. And when she was about 8 years old, he died. He was a young man. He was maybe in his late 40s, early 40s. And it broke her heart, truly, because she truly hero worshipped him. And her name was Helen Goff. And she lived in Australia. And she decided at the age of 23, she was going to leave Australia behind her and never remember anything about herself. She changed her name to Pamela, because she liked the name Pamela. Lyndon, her middle name was Lyndon. And then she took her father's first name, which was Travers. His name was Travers Goff. And she called herself Pamela Lyndon Travers, P.L. Travers. Now, P.L. Travers grew up in England, in Australia, until she was 23. Then she became a writer of poetry and a commentary writer in newspapers, mostly in Ireland, because she wanted to think of herself as Irish royalty or something. She had this strange thing about herself. And of course, we knew nothing whatever about her background. All we knew at the time when we were given the books, there was somebody named P.L. Travers. We thought it was a man to begin with. We didn't know. And then when Walt finally sprang it upon us that it was a woman and we'd have to get her permission to do the picture, after a year and a half of slaving away on the book and the music and the lyrics of our property that we've been working on with Don DeGrady, this wonderful guy. So basically the three of us were put into a very strange position. We were in the lion's cage. We were thrown into the lion's cage with the lioness. And she was not easy. What was my opinion? Well, she was difficult. She was very defensive. And by being defensive, she was offensive. Because she would not like anything. She just deliberately not like anything. She preceded things by saying, "And what kind of ditties are you going to play for me today?" I mean, it was that type of thing. 10 days of this attrition. It was a terrible time. We just couldn't get through to her. And at one point, if you've seen the movie, you know this, but I'll just say it anyhow. At one point, Walt was not even there. He couldn't stand her. But he said, "You got to sell her, guys. Just sell her. You've got something. Sell it to her." And that was, it was up to us, just the three of us. And at one point, I remember we had a discussion with Walt. His secretary called us and said, "Play the finale where he fixes the kite, where the father fixes the kite. That might get her." So, because we couldn't get past page 12. I mean, she just kept guiding us insane with every detail. And this was not even a script. She kept referring to it as script. It was only an outline. But basically, we played her "Let's Go Fly a Kite," where the father mends the kite, takes the family out and flies the kite. She dubbed that. She really did. And it's true that Don DeGrady did dance with her in that moment. It was a miracle. She just transformed. And then at the end, of course, she said, "Of course, it should be Let Us Go and Fly." So we said, "Right, well, we'll take that into consideration." It was an ordeal. She was a difficult lady. She was very inexperienced in the idea of taking this wonderful series of stories and making a story for the screen to keep people interested, glued in their chair for 2 hours or more. This is something you have to have a story, something you're pulling for, something you're worried about, something that pulls you. And she didn't have it in her book. She really didn't. Of course, we couldn't say that to her. So we said, we made up these, the father had faults, that he wasn't paying attention to the children. And he thought we were trying to destroy her father, because Mr. Banks was really her father that she had created. But we didn't know any of this backstory with her. And so we were fighting shadows. We didn't know what we were fighting. It was a terrible time for us.
Well, in the miracle department, the film turned out to be a masterpiece. And
She made a lot of money. You told me, just briefly, a wonderful story about a song you wrote for Mary Poppins that didn't get used in the movie called The Eyes of Love, which is a beautiful song, if you've never heard it. And when you played it for Julie Andrews, she was very nice about it, but what happened after that, and what song did it lead to?
Well, I would like to just precede telling you this by saying that Julie Andrews came up through show business. She was a show business girl from the time she was 5 years old with this freak voice that could sing four octaves. I mean, and she had perfect pitch. She was an incredible walking instrument, if you want to call it that. Because she was an amazing child actor and singer. And as she grew and grew, she heard all kinds of performances by all kinds of vaudevillians and show people. She used to do eight a day and six a day in vaudeville houses. I mean, she just came up with her mother and stepfather, and they did these shows. Remarkably experienced. And so when we were talking with her, and when we performed our things for her, she would immediately transfer it to how it would play for the audience with the context of what we were doing. And she really dug most of the things that we played for her that were written for this picture. But we had this very pretty ballad with the story of life is how you look at it. It's how you choose to look at something. And you see things through the eyes of love in a beautiful way. You see through the eyes of doubt or hate in a different way. And we had this very, very pretty song, which we thought could be sung on a seashore with a voiceover and they're walking along. It just was a very nice, we wanted a gentle thought in there before we hit supercalifragilistic, which was kind of a funny song. So we had this song as part of the original song ideas for the picture. And she, with the knowledge of what the audience would be doing, could see the audience squirming at this one. She could, no matter how pretty it was not a question that she didn't like the song, she just didn't feel it would work for the film. And the good of the film is what it's all about. The good of the show is what it's all about in show business. You gotta just lose things if they don't work for the show. And so in this particular case, she felt for the good of the show, you don't need that song. And God bless her, because of her, we wrote one of the biggest hits we ever wrote. That was A Spoonful of Sugar. It's exactly the same thought, but we did it with a bright, happy tune and a happy thought, and it became a whole different thing.
How did it feel to not only go to the Academy Awards for Mary Poppins, but to come home with two of them?
Oh, well, you know.